subgroups. Before we learn definition of subgroup, we'll define what is a complex. We know that any non-empty subset of a real number system is called an aggregate. Then what is a complex? A complex is any subset of a group G. Any subset of a group G is called a complex of G. Example, the set of natural numbers n is a complex of the group set of integers, comma, plus. Because n is a subset of set of integers z. The set of integers z is a complex of the group r comma plus, the algebraic structure r comma plus, since z is a subset of the group, namely capital R, set of real numbers together with a binary operation addition. The set of odd integers is a complex of the group, algebraic structure r comma plus. The set 1 comma minus 1 is a complex of the multiplicative group G equals to the set containing elements 1 minus 1 I minus I. The set 1 and minus 1 is a subset of 1 comma minus 1 comma I comma minus I. Therefore, it is a complex of the multiplicative group G. Multiplication of two complexes. If M and N are two complexes of a group G, that is M and N are subset of G, then the product M and N is defined as set of all elements M and M into small n, such that M is from capital M and the element small n is from capital N, and M and N is called the product of two complexes M comma N of G. Clearly, M into N is a subset of G. Not only M and N, the product M N is also a subset of G. That is, multiplication of two complexes is again a complex. If M is a complex in a group G, then we define M inverse, set of all inverses of capital M, and since elements of M belong to G, M inverse also must be in G. Therefore, clearly M inverse is a subset of G, and M inverse is the set of all inverses of the elements of capital M. Similarly, M N inverse is equals to the set containing M into N inverse, where small m is from capital M and small n is from capital N. And we know that the reversal law, that is M N inverse is equals to N inverse into M inverse. Therefore, this is equals to the set of all elements containing N inverse into M inverse, where N is from capital N, small m is from capital M, that is also denoted by capital N inverse into capital M inverse. That is, the set of all complexes also obey reversal law. The multiplication of complexes of a group G is associative. If M and N are two complexes in a group G, then M N inverse equals to N inverse into M inverse. Now, we are going to define what is a subgroup. Let algebraic structure G, circle be a group and H be a non-empty subset of G, such that the algebraic structure H, dot be a group, then H is called a subgroup of G. It is denoted by H less than or equals to G. This symbol is not less than or equal to. Here, this stands for subgroup. The very important point is the binary operation in a group and its subgroups are the same. Here is a dot, it must be dot. If it is addition, it must be addition. If it is multiplication, it must be multiplication. Therefore, the binary operation in a group and its subgroups must be the same. For example, z comma plus is a group. That is, set of integers with respect to ordinary addition is a group. The set of even integers e is a subgroup of set of integers comma plus, because the set of even integers, namely 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, so on, minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, minus 8, minus 10, so on, the set forms a group. Since E is a subset of Z, therefore the set of even integers is a subgroup of the group set of integers with respect to the ordinary addition. The set of odd integers O, capital O, is not a subgroup of Z comma plus. The reason is 0 is not there. 0 is not odd number, and hence identity fails here. Also, closure axiom fails because sum of two odd number is an even number. That is, sum of two odd number is not belong to O, it belongs to E, and hence it is not a subgroup. The set of integers with respect to ordinary addition is a subgroup of set of rational numbers with respect to the same operation plus. The algebraic structure z comma dot, here dot stands for multiplication, is a subgroup of the algebraic structure q comma dot. Q plus, considering all positive rational numbers with respect to multiplication, is a subgroup of the set of positive real numbers with respect to the multiplication. We know that the algebraic structure r comma r plus comma dot is a group. The algebraic structure q plus comma dot is also a group, but q plus is a subset of r plus. Therefore, q plus comma dot is a subgroup of r plus comma dot. The multiplicative group 1 comma minus 1 is a subgroup of the multiplicative group g equals to 1 minus 1 I minus I. That is, the algebraic structure 1 comma minus 1, the set containing 1 and minus 1 with respect to multiplication, and the algebraic structure 1 comma minus 1 I comma minus I with respect to multiplication are subgroups of G. Some results, we call it as a theorem. The identity of a subgroup H of a group G is same as the identity of G. If H is any subgroup of a group G, then H into H is equals to H. If H is any subgroup of a group G, then H inverse must be equals to H. The converse of the above theorem is not true. That is, H inverse is equal to H. If H is any subset or complex of the group G such that H inverse is equal to H, then H need not be a subgroup of G. Theorem. H is a non-empty complex of a group G. The necessary and sufficient condition for H to be a subgroup of G is A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H, where B inverse is the inverse of B in G. Proof. The condition is necessary. Here we are given that H is a subgroup of a group G. Now we have to show that A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H. Since H is a group by itself, B belongs to H implies B inverse belongs to H. A comma B belongs to H. Since we have taken two arbitrary elements A and B from H, this implies A belongs to H. Since B belongs to H implies B inverse belongs to H, now we can write B inverse belongs to H. By closure axiom, we have A into B inverse belongs to H. Thus, A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H. Hence, the condition is necessary. This is the first part of the theorem. Now, the second part of the theorem is sufficient condition or only if part. Here we are given that H is a non-empty complex of the group G and A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H, where B inverse is the inverse of B in G. Here we have to show that H is a subgroup of the group G. That is, we have to show that H satisfies closure axiom, associative axiom, identity and inverse. This theorem is something different from other theorems. Normally, in theorems and problems, first we prove closure axiom, then we prove associative, then identity and hence inverse. Whereas in this theorem, we are going to first prove the existence of identity. For all A belong to H, there exists E belongs to H such that A into E equals to E into A equals to A. Since H not equal to empty, that is H is non-empty, let A belong to H. By hypothesis, A comma B belong to H implies A B inverse belongs to H. Now, we are going to take B equals to A. That is, in the place of B, we are going to write A. Therefore, A belongs to H comma A belongs to H implies A into A inverse belongs to H. This by the hypothesis. This implies A into A inverse belongs to G because H is a non-empty complex of G. That is, H is a subset of G. Whatever elements are in H, all those elements must be in G. Therefore, A inverse belongs to H implies A inverse belongs to G. But in G, A belongs to G implies A into A inverse equals to E, where E is the identity in G. Therefore, now we can write E belongs to H, because what is A into A inverse? A into A inverse is E. Therefore, when you say A into A inverse belongs to H, we say E belongs to H. Thus, we have proved that identity element exists in H, and this identity is same as the identity in G. Now, existence of inverse. For every A belongs to H, there exists B belongs to H such that AB equals to E equals to B into A, where B is the inverse of A and E is the identity. We have E belongs to A and A belongs to H, because in the previous step only we have shown that E is an element of H and A is already taken as an arbitrary element in H. Therefore, by hypothesis, E into A inverse belongs to H. E into A inverse is A inverse because E is the identity element and hence A belongs to H implies A inverse belongs to H. A is an arbitrary element in H. Therefore, we say that existence of inverse is true for every element of H. That is, inverse exists for each and every element in H. Now we are going to prove closure axiom. Generally, we prove closure first, then associative, then identity, then inverse. But in this theorem, we first prove the identity, then existence of inverse. Using this, we are going to prove closure axiom. A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H is the closure axiom. Let us choose B belongs to H. Since inverse exists for every element in H, B inverse belongs to H. Therefore, A belongs to H, B belongs to H implies A belongs to H. Since B belongs to H implies B inverse belongs to H, this implies A into B inverse of inverse belongs to H by hypothesis. Hypothesis says that if there are two elements A and B, then A into B inverse belongs to H. So in the place of A, we write A. Here it becomes B inverse of inverse, and we know that B inverse of inverse is B. Therefore, A into B belongs to H. Thus, A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H. Now we will prove the associative axiom. Since all the elements of H are in G, the reason is H is a non-empty complex of G, and since the composition in G is associative because G is a group, the composition is associative in H. Thus, H is a group for the composition in G, and hence H is a subgroup of the group G. If the operation in G is addition, then the conditions of the above theorem can be stated as follows. A belong to H, comma B belong to H implies A minus B belong to H. That is, the inverse of B is B inverse with respect to multiplication. The inverse of B is minus B with respect to addition. Therefore, AB inverse becomes now A minus B. Thus, A comma B belong to H implies A minus B belongs to H. This is called one-step subgroup test because we have only one step to prove it. If you want to show that a non-empty complex of a group to be a subgroup, it is enough to show that A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H or A minus B belong to H. So hereafter, we need not prove all the four axioms. Just one axiom is enough. So to prove a non-empty complex of a group G to be a subgroup of G, only one condition is enough. That is, A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belong to H. So we need not verify all the four axioms. It is enough to verify only one axiom, namely AB inverse belong to H for all A comma B belong to H. That is why it is called one-step subgroup test. The necessary and sufficient condition for a finite complex H of a group G to be a subgroup of G is A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H. The only difference between the previous theorem and this theorem is, in the previous theorem, the H is infinite. Whereas here, is very clearly it is given that H is a finite complex of G. Therefore, in the previous statement, A comma B belong to H implies AB inverse belongs to H. Whereas here, A comma B belong to H implies A into B belong to H. That is, if any finite complex H of a group G to be a subgroup or to be a group, it has to satisfy only the closure axiom, because A comma B belong to H implies A B belong to H is the closure axiom. Whereas the previous theorem, it may be only one condition. One is the existence of inverse, other is closure axiom. A comma B belong to H implies A B inverse belong to H. Whereas here A comma B belong to H implies simply A B belong to H. The condition is necessary. We are given that H is a finite subgroup of a group G. Now we have to show that A comma B belong to H implies A B belong to H. Since H is a subgroup of G, H itself is a group, and hence H satisfies all the four axioms, namely closure, associative, identity, inverse. Hence, by closure axiom, A comma B belong to H implies A B belong to H, and hence the condition is necessary. The condition is sufficient. Here we are given that H is a finite complex of the group G. That is, H is a finite subset of G, such that A comma B belong to H implies AB belong to H. AB belongs to H. We call it as 1. Now we have to prove that H is a subgroup of G. For that we have to show that H must satisfy four axioms, that is closure, associative, identity and inverse. Since the hypothesis says that A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H, that is nothing but the closure axiom, and hence given hypothesis. The closure axiom is proved by given hypothesis. Therefore, it is enough to prove only the three axioms, namely associative, identity and inverse. This is the associative law. A comma B comma C belong to H imply A dot B dot C equal to A dot B dot C. Here the dot stands for the binary operation. All the elements of H are also elements of G. The reason is H is a finite subset of G. Therefore, since H is a subset of G, all the elements of H are also in G. Since G is a group, the composition in G is associative, and hence the composition in H is also associative. Now let us prove the existence of identity. The identity axiom says that for all A belong to H that exists, E belongs to H such that A into E equal to E into A equal to A, where E is known as the identity element. By 1. 1 says that A comma B belong to H implies A B belongs to H. That is the hypothesis. A comma A belong to H. In the place of B, let us take same element A. This implies A into B belong to H. Here it is A into A belongs to H. A into B belongs to H, but here it is A into A belongs to H. This implies A squared belongs to H. Now take A belongs to H. Just now we have shown that A squared belongs to H by hypothesis. Therefore, take another element as A squared belongs to H. Whenever A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H. Therefore, here we are taking A equal to A and B equal to A square. Therefore, A into A square belongs to H. What is A into A square? That is A cubed belongs to H. Proceeding in this way, we can prove that A power 4 belongs to H, A power 5 belongs to H, A power m belongs to H, or any integral power of A belongs to H. where m is a natural number. Thus, a belongs to h, a square belongs to h, a cube belongs to h, a power 4 belongs to h, a power m belongs to h. So, on any integral power of m belongs to h. How many elements are here? A squared, a power 3, a power 4, a power m, so on. There are infinitely many elements. These elements are infinite. What are these elements? The elements are a squared, a power 3, a power 4, a power m, so on. So they are all infinite in number. But what is h? But h is finite complex of G. It's a finite. Now h is finite. We are given h is finite. But now with the help of the hypothesis, we have arrived at a squared, a power 3, a power 4, a power m, so on, all belong to h. That is, we have shown that there are infinitely many elements in h, but h must be finite. Since h is finite, and we have shown that there are infinitely many elements in h, since h is finite, and we have shown that there are infinitely many elements in H, there must be repetition in this collection of elements. Therefore, for some positive integers r, s with r is greater than s, we must have a power r equal to a power s. The reason is h is finite, but here there are infinitely many elements in h. Therefore, some of the elements must be repeated, maybe once or twice or any number of times. Let us assume that a to the power r equal to a to the power s, and we have taken r is greater than s. Therefore, multiply both sides by a to the power minus s, because a power minus s is in G. So, multiply both sides by a power minus s. That is pre-multiplied by a to the power minus s. This implies a to the power r minus s equals to a to the power s minus s is 0. A to the power 0 is e. That is the identity element in G. Therefore, since r minus s is a positive integer, the reason is r is greater than s, therefore r minus s is greater than 0. Therefore, r minus s is a positive integer, comma a to the power r minus s is e, that is also in h, because any integral power of a must be in h. Thus, we have shown that identity element exists in h. Now we will show that inverse exists for every element in H. Let us take R is greater than S. This implies R minus S is greater than 0, or R minus S is greater than R equals to 1. This implies R minus S minus 1 is greater than R equal to 0. That is, take this 1 to the left hand side, we get R minus S minus 1 is greater than R equals to 0. This implies A to the power R minus S minus 1 must be in H, because A squared, A power 3, A power 4, A power m, so on, must be in H. Now, let us multiply a r to the power minus s minus 1 with a. That is equals to a to the power r minus s minus 1 into a power 1. We have to add the powers. When you add the powers, we get r minus s minus 1 plus 1, that is equal to r minus s. But r minus s, a to the power r minus s is equal to a power 0, that is equal to identity, as we have proved in the previous slide. Therefore, that is equals to e. That is also can be written as a into a to the power r minus s minus 1. Thus, the inverse of A is A to the power R minus S minus 1. That is, A inverse is equals to A to the power R minus S minus 1. Thus, inverse exists for A. What is A? A is any arbitrary element in H. Therefore, inverse exists for each and every element in H. This implies that each element of H is invertible. Therefore, H is a group and hence H is a subgroup of G. Hence, the statement says that a finite complex H of a group G is a subgroup of G if and only if A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H. That is, it consists of two parts. The first part is a finite complex with A comma B belong to H implies AB belongs to H. Then H must be a subgroup. The other part is H is a finite complex of H and H is a subgroup. That implies AB belongs to H implies AB belongs to H. Thus, hereafter if you want to prove a finite subset of a group G to be a subgroup of G, it is enough to verify only one axiom, namely the closure axiom, that is A comma B belong to H implies A into B belongs to H.